right now is the golden age of dinosaurs. In terms of the scientific understanding of them, essentially have a new species of dinosaur every week. We also have this entirely new understanding of what the animals actually looked like when they were alive.
We try to show behaviors of dinosaurs that are unexpected and also unexpected dinosaurs.
Wired spoke with Tim Walker and Dr. Darren Neige to explore how filmmakers and scientists work together to bring prehistoric species to life on screen. In Apple's new doc series, Prehistoric Planet, filmmakers brought to life dinosaurs in some ways we've never seen, and others for the very first time. New research and discoveries about dinosaurs in the last decade meant that filmmakers needed to reconcile popular depictions to the new research available. Take the T-Rex.
We have what are called trace fossils, and these are scrape marks which have been left by theropod dinosaurs, left in sediment on the bottom of waterways. And then you look at the bones of a T-Rex, they are air-filled. If you reconstruct in computer modeling a T-Rex body, all indicating that T-Rex would have been a swimmer.
Tyrannosaurus and other predatory dinosaurs, they almost certainly didn't have the kind of crocodile-like faces. Scientific evidence currently indicates that these animals actually had quite a lot of soft tissue on the face. They would have structures that we call lips, but they're not lips like what we have. They're more like the lips of lizards and snakes.
Lots of depictions of dinosaurs, they're like super bodybuilders when we see them. But in reality, when you look across the animal kingdom and you see animals that have a healthy lifestyle, they are often very different to how you depict dinosaurs. So our T-Rex is quite chunky.
In addition to reimagining fan favorites like the T-Rex, the team depicted 12 rarely seen species.
What could be cooler, dinosaurs and snow? There's a wonderful dinosaur called Nanuksaurus, which is a type of Tyrannosaur. It would have been perfectly adapted to its environment. The Nanuksaur is rather cunning. It looks amazing as well. The Oleratitan is a type of hadrosaur. The name means giant swan neck. It's a beautiful creature. We show it moving into a nesting area where it ultimately uses geothermal energy to incubate the eggs.
So we've known since the 1980s that there were dinosaurs of all kinds, large and small, living in the far north and the far south.
But a 2021 discovery of baby dinosaur bones in Alaska push researchers to consider that dinosaurs lived year-round in the cold.
So these were animals that must have coped with seasonal polar darkness and freezing cold temperatures and thick snow. It's entirely new, it's entirely radical to most of the people that are going to see the episode, but it's absolutely scientifically legit.
So we kick the episode off with giant titanosaur sauropods called Dreadnoughtus. We then see incredibly adorned pterosaurs called Barbarodactylus. And we close the episode with a wonderful story about Cicernosaurus traveling across sand dunes. Dreadnoughtus is a South American titanosaur. It's got a huge long neck, really long tail, massive.
The giant plant-eating dinosaurs were probably the most dangerous of the dinosaurs. Think about the living world. There's no such thing as a gentle giant. They're the animals you stay away from.
Barbarodactylus is a fabulous animal that features in the deserts episode. It's a pterosaur that's got a huge, huge head crest. You know, if we look in the animal kingdom, any time that an animal has something which doesn't really have a mechanical function, usually always associated with some kind of display purpose, usually for attracting a mate or warding off rivals. We show Velociraptor looking very different to what people have got used to seeing over the last few years. Velociraptor was around about the size of a big turkey and covered in feathers. Still had a big claw, so it'd be a pretty vicious turkey. Throughout Prehistoric Planet, we don't just feature dinosaurs. So dinosaurs were quite a specific group of animals that lived on land. The things in the air we call flying reptiles, and the things in the water we call marine reptiles.
These specialized marine reptiles, none of them laid eggs. They give birth to live babies in the water. This kind of plesiosaur, Tyrannosaurus. And we've been able to show that give births in our coast episode by a discovery. It's actually a fossil that's on display in Los Angeles County Museum, where there's a pregnant plesiosaur. So we know for sure that plesiosaurs like Tyrannosaurus gave birth to these giant babies. Now, if you give birth to a giant baby, and again, this is something seen across the animal world, they generally undergo parental care. So we've got very good reason for thinking that plesiosaurs like Tyrannosaurus lived in complex family groups, looked after their babies. Now, in the last several decades, there's actually been a scientific revolution. Kaikaifulu is a mosasaur. People used to show mosasaurs as kind of like crocodile-like animals. That is completely wrong. Beautiful fossils, all discovered since about the year 2000, have shown that they were more like kind of whale lizards. They were these big, chubby, streamlined animals, and they had a vertical tail fin, kind of like a shark. One of the frogs that lived in the late Cretaceous, specifically in Madagascar, was probably the most remarkable frog ever. It's called Beelzebufo, this predatory, broad-bodied frog. It looks kind of similar to the modern Pac-Man frogs and the Pixie frogs. Scientists have worked out, based on the bite strength of living frogs, that Beelzebufo would have bitten at a strength of round about 2,000 newtons. It's about the same as the bite force of like a lion or a tiger. So a frog that can grab like an animal, like a small dinosaur, subdue it with this really powerful bite force, and then eat it.
Magicosaurus, you know, when we see it, it's got babies with it. We've got a giant toad and we've got some baby dinosaurs, and kind of guess what happens. I think a lot of people think that dinosaurs lived in swamps or in deserts, but we know that the planet was covered in a lot of forest and that dinosaurs were found in those forests. A cool one we feature is Chinchosaurus, which is a type of tyrannosaur. It's got a colloquial name, which is Pinocchio Rex, because it's got a really elongated snout. And we show it in association with a beautiful dinosaur called Corythoraptor.
The conventional view of dinosaurs that's still really familiar to us through most mainstream media is that dinosaurs were boring and brown and pretty ugly animals, and all they did was roar at each other and attack each other. Dinosaurs, non-bird dinosaurs, were showy, flamboyant, often attractive animals. They would have been sending signals to each other, you know, head shakes and arm waving and tail wiggling, all this kind of stuff, all the time. So if you were lucky enough to travel back in time to see these animals in life, you would be just blown away by how showy and amazing they were in appearance.